Well, we've been collaborating with OSSI, the Italian Space Agency, now for, probably 50 years or so. They are a critical partner of ours. As a member of the European Space Agency, they also play a critical role in enabling ESA to fulfill their objectives in their partnership with us also. So we have a number of bilateral projects that we work with them. They have not only an Italian astronaut on the International Space Station right now as a member of the six-person crew, but there is a permanent logistics module, the MPLM, Multi-Purpose Logistics Module, that was actually built in Italy that is a part of the International Space Station now. So they've been a critical partner for some time. They're just like any other astronaut. I guess that's the message I would give to anybody. I don't look at them as female astronauts. I look at them as regular astronauts. When you look at the tasks that are done aboard the International Space Station today, the qualifications for getting there are pretty rigid. There are three things that every candidate has to do, and the eight that we just announced, they are the eight selected because they were superb in their language aptitude. Everyone has to be proficient in Russian, and they also have to be able to learn other languages because as we associate with our international partners and we collaborate, frequently you find yourself in another country where it's easier to talk to the internet, to the other principal investigators, if you can communicate in their language or at least understand it. The second big thing is adaptability for robotic operations. Working robotic systems, whether it's the International Space Station arm produced by the Canadians or whether it's the arm that's on the back of the Japanese experiment module Kibo, or whether it's an arm on any other type of vehicle. And then the third and perhaps the most challenging is they have to have an adaptability or an ability to do spacewalks. Every single crew member is equally qualified to do anything. So again, I'd say while it is significant that 50% of this group coming in happens to be female, there's really nothing significant about the fact that they were among the most highly qualified from the 6,300 applicants that came down to eight selections. And I think he is doing an incredible job so far. The thing that I'm excited about and I would congratulate him on is the manner in which he has, with such ease, come into classrooms around the world on our daily downlinks to students to talk about what's going on the International Space Station, to try to make his experience real for them, to try to make them feel like they're a part of the crew there, and he and his crew members are doing a really good job. I actually have been an astronaut myself, but I consider myself sort of a has-been because there's been more time since I was in the astronaut office than I spent in the office. I flew my last flight in 1994. I am very proud to say that it was sort of the precursor for what we do today on the International Space Station because it was the first joint Russian-American shuttle mission in which we flew a Russian cosmonaut, Sergei Krikalev, as a full crew member, a mission specialist on that flight. Sergei went on, I left, and Sergei went on to be a member of the very first International Space Station crew, went back to command it on a subsequent flight, and today, if I have it right, he holds the record for total time in space by any other human being, and I count it a privilege to call him a friend and a colleague. And he also today is actually the head of the Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center outside of Mostico, what we call Star City. So it's good to see another member of the STS-60 crew doing well.